These are the memories that we find a way, pushing through the day. So speak to me gently. Can you just feel the time falling from some place new? Can you just feel the sign? Love waits for you. Love waits for you. Searching the stars in desperate hours, bound to find meaning. And God shows a face in this desolate place, and tenderness meets me. Can you just feel
good morning, Creekside. We're so glad that you're here this morning with us. Let's go ahead and stand together as we begin with worship this morning.
Thank you. Morning, Creekside. We're going to sing the song that I grew up singing. It's a very simple song. It's all who are thirsty, all who are weak, come to the fountain. Dip your heart in the stream of life. Let the pain and the sorrow be washed away in the waves of his mercy. As deep cries out to deep, we sing, come, Lord Jesus, come. And it's an invitation that we have, a constant invitation from him towards us. And not only does he invite us, but he made a way. So I encourage you, it's a simple song, but it's a massive invitation. It's a simple song to sing, but it can be a very difficult thing to actually do, is to accept an invitation. So I encourage you guys, if it takes a couple choruses, if it takes one chorus, if it takes you not singing and just to pause and be still, whatever it takes, if you can accept the hand that is reaching out towards you, for a God who created everything that we know and who wants to know us so dearly as our friend, as our Savior, and as our Father. Sing Holy Spirit.
We sing Holy Spirit come. We sing Holy Spirit
that you need him.
We sing, come, Lord Jesus, come.
Maybe you don't even know, but you just feel pain. Invite him in.
Come, Lord Jesus, come.
Last time, let's sing Holy Spirit.
We sing, Holy Spirit.
Thank you.
You this morning. God, you are the only thing that can satisfy us. Lord, whatever those burdens are, whatever those weariness things are in our lives that are keeping us from you, I pray that we would lift those up to you, that we would lift our burdens up to you. That we would know that you are the only one that satisfies our hearts. We thank you that you are here in this place with us, that you are walking beside us, no matter where we are, no matter what we've done. I ask for those souls, Lord, that feel weary, that you would come and you would refresh. Refresh us this morning with your Spirit. We thank you that we can come and bring our praise, bring our worship to you. So we just give you this time this morning. Speak to our hearts as we open up your word and hear from you. We thank you for who you are. In your name, amen.
When I was in seminary, Western seminary that was actually attached to our building, so I knew about Creekside before I actually worked here. But seminary is a place where saints, men and women, go to be equipped for the mission field, to be ready to either step into a pastoral role or back into their normal jobs as missionaries on a mission to make other saints of Jesus. And one class, I had a professor ask the entire class this question: do the Ten Commandments still apply today? Do the Ten Commandments still apply today? The commandments that God gave his people within the first five books of the Bible to show his people how to live holy lives. Do those Ten Commandments still apply today? And you would be surprised, in a classroom full of people ready to be on the mission field, we were not unanimous in our decision. In fact, there was a little bit of an argument or a debate that broke out in the class, especially over the fourth commandment. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. We see this idea of Sabbath at the very beginning of the Bible. In fact, within the first two pages, we see that God created everything, but on the seventh day he rested. In the Jewish tradition, the Sabbath is a 24-hour period of time where you cease from work and seek to dwell in the presence of God. And in our class, there were people who thought there was no need of a Sabbath anymore. As I remember, people basically said there is no need for that kind of rest anymore. Now, I've really thought about this debate that took place in our class a lot as I've been a pastor and as I've thought about my own journey in ministry. As there have been points where I'm exhausted, where I'm headed towards burnout. And then I remember and I think about how when I Sabbath, it provides me the rest I need, but it also provides me the strength I need for the other 6 days of the week. When I don't Sabbath, it's hard for me to be present with people. It's hard for me to show mercy and grace and sympathy towards others. The Sabbath is not something you can just write off as a command that is not necessary. In the Bible, God gives his commands to his people not to prohibit us or to restrict us, but instead to show us how to truly live and rest in him. And interestingly enough, the Sabbath is the longest of all the Ten Commandments. This image doesn't really do it justice. So why would a class full of seminary students have a debate about the importance of not just this command, but of all these commands? Well, if we're honest with ourselves, we aren't much different. I mean, if we look at this list, we can understand why we shouldn't have idols. We can understand why we shouldn't kill, or although the word should be murder, or that we shouldn't commit adultery. We shouldn't steal. It's easy to see why we shouldn't do all those other things, but it's a lot harder to think of, should I give up a 24-hour period of time to simply rest in God's presence? That is foreign to us. And the reason why is we are consumers of hustle culture. We are consumers of the material world and the digital world. We live in a culture where hustle, consumption, and work and hurry are celebrated as something to be our gods. And our own lives, we have so much input and noise that we don't recognize that out of the 7 days a week, God is simply asking for one of them. When we look at ourselves and when we really look at our own lives and the people around us, are we willing to give God one day? Are we willing to put our phone aside for 24 hours? Because when I look out in the world, when I sit in my reading chair and I look out our big window in our front yard and I see kids walking to school, one, I'm scared for them because I know how fast cars go by, and they're just sitting there like this. There are beautiful trees in my neighborhood. There's a creek that goes by with amazing oaks right there, and the kids are glued to their phone. And it's not just kids. Let's be honest, people. I've seen you guys at stoplights. The scary part, though, is when you're on the freeway and you look over as somebody passes you and their eyes are down at their phone. We are constantly putting input in our lives. Do we ever take a moment to pause and look up at the world around us? When we look at our culture, when we look at our own lives, are we creating space to rest? Are we creating space to rest? A day to delight in what God has given us. A day to pursue joy instead of consumption. A day to cease from work and our wants. A day to rest and delight and find joy in the very people and the creation around us. Because the art of Sabbath leads us into the art of rest, delight, and joy. The Sabbath is a defiance in a day and age of hustle and hurry. And I believe that it is a day that we all must adopt in order to combat this cultural moment. Because our lives are busy. But God is inviting us into his presence. God is inviting us into his rest. And as I already said, this very idea of the Sabbath is right there in the very beginning of Scripture. But if we are completely honest, as a Christian culture, we don't really respect or have reverence for the first half of this book. We like to hear sermons from the New Testament. That's nice. But what we don't understand is that the Old Testament points to the very person that the Old Testament points to the very person the New Testament is about. And so in a moment, we are going to look from Genesis all the way throughout the Bible at the theme of the Sabbath. But first, I want us to look at a New Testament passage that tells us that the Sabbath still remains. So if you have your Bibles, turn with me to Hebrews 4, and we're going to look at verses 8 through 13. Hebrews 4, 8 through 13 says this. For if Joshua had given them rest, God would not have spoken of another day later on. So then there remains a Sabbath rest for the people of God. For whoever has entered God's rest has also rested from his works as God did from his. Let us therefore strive to enter that rest so that no one may fall by the same sort of disobedience. For the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of soul and of spirit, of joints and of marrow, and discerning the thoughts and intentions of the heart. And no creature is hidden from his sight, but all are naked and exposed to the eyes of him to whom we give an account. Verse 9 right here shows us in the New Testament, the second half of the Bible, that there remains a Sabbath rest for the people of God. And we see that the example of this in verse 10 is God. He rested on the seventh day of creation. And that is what we are invited into. 6 days to work to honor God with our work. But then the seventh day, we honor God with our rest. And we see this invitation from the very beginning of pages in this Bible, that God is inviting us into his rest. His people are invited into his very presence, and yet they and we fall into constant disobedience of this. And that's why verse 11 says, strive to enter this rest. Now remember, our faith is sealed by the grace of God and the gospel of Jesus Christ. When we believe that, we have Jesus. We have the Holy Spirit. But when we accept Jesus in our lives as our Lord and Savior, we are going to need to take steps to sit in relationship with him and relationship with God and the creator of the universe. But let's be honest, we don't honor the Sabbath. We don't strive to enter into this rest, because the truth is that the Sabbath is an act of relational trust. When we rest in God, we grow in our trust of God. When we learn that we can trust God's word, we understand that it is active. It's sharper than any two-edged sword, that it pierces the very soul and joints and hardships that we have. Why? Because as John 1 says, the word became flesh and dwelt among us. Jesus is the one that transforms our hearts. Jesus is the one that sees our souls and yet died on the cross for us. This is the man that has the power to transform our hearts, minds, and souls. And Jesus is our pathway to the relationship with a loving God. A God that wants a relationship with you, not just to accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior, but because you are his child. And we're not hidden from God. We see that in these verses right here. No creature is hidden from his sight. And even in that, a God that knows what you are doing, what you have done, and what you will do, he wants you to come to him and rest in his presence. This is a God that loves you no matter what you will do. And he invites you into a Sabbath rest, a rest of relational trust with the creator of the universe. So Lord, as we jump into your word and as we look at Genesis and Exodus and all the books in which you bring up the Sabbath, Lord, and your rest and encourage us to delight, Lord, I must first confess that I have not always kept your Sabbath. That in this season, I have not honored you with simply sitting before you and trusting you with a 24-hour day. So, Lord, I am sorry for that. But, Lord, help me and everyone else here understand that the Sabbath gives us a pathway for our souls to come home. I pray these things in your Son's name. Amen. Before we dive into the art of Sabbath, I would love, first of all, to say good morning. Yeah, good morning, Creekside. It's great to have you all here. My name is Nathan. I'm the associate pastor here. During Mark's sabbatical, our head pastor, we are going through a sermon series called The Art of Being, a series in which we are inviting everyone to try out the different spiritual disciplines, all for the purpose of inviting you to the process of intentionally cultivating space to be with Jesus, to be transformed by Jesus, and then to live the way Jesus lived. And if we are going to do this, we will have to learn the art of Sabbath. Now, if you know anything about the Sabbath, what you must understand, first of all, is when I bring this up to a lot of different Christians, a lot of things they will say to me is, oh, that's a Jewish tradition. Yeah, it's a Jewish tradition. But guess what? Jesus was Jewish. And if we're meant to live the way Jesus lived, we might have to adopt some of the customs of our Jewish friends. Because if this is a Jewish custom, Jesus would have practiced it himself. And so why do we not think we need to enter into the Sabbath rest anymore? When it's present here in Hebrews, but it's also present at the very beginning of Scripture, in creation. We then see it woven throughout the Torah, the first five books of the Bible. We see it mentioned in the wisdom literature, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, and Job. We see it in the rest of the Old Testament just there. All over the place. We see that Jesus talks about it. And then, of course, we just read about Hebrews mentioning it. The very first couple of pages, Genesis 2:2-3, says this. It says, "And on the seventh day, God finished his work that he had done, and he rested on the seventh day from all his work that he had done. So God blessed the seventh day and made it holy." Because on it, God rested from all his work that he had done in creation. The first thing we can see from this section of Scripture is that God leads by example. And in the Old Testament, he calls his people to adopt this way of life, to enter into a Sabbath on the seventh day. As I prepped for this, I read a book by a Jewish theologian, and it says that there are actually 7 days of creation. We see that in the first 6 days of creation that God created the heavens and the earth and everything that dwells in it. But on the seventh day, we see tranquility, serenity, and peace created. Could it be that on the seventh day, God created rest? Could it be that the Ten Commandments that include Sabbath in them that God gave us are not something to hinder us, but they are actually there to make us more like Jesus? Because in the Ten Commandments, we do see that the Sabbath is the longest commandment. In both Exodus and Deuteronomy, which are a part of the Torah, we see that the commandments are mentioned. And here is what the book of Exodus says about the Sabbath command. It says, "Remember the Sabbath, to keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath day to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, you or your son or your daughter, your male servant or your female servant, or your livestock, or the sojourner who is within your gates. For in 6 days the Lord made the heaven and earth, the sea and all that is in them, and rested on the seventh day. Therefore, the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. God gives us his commandments to show us how to truly live. If Jesus was a Jewish man, he would have followed the commandments. And he did. The Sabbath, though, in that day, it got morphed. Because as we continue to read the scriptures and as we begin to see how there's hints of rest in the Psalms, just a longing to delight in God, a longing to trust in God, we read these different passages about wanting to see rest and delight in all these different books of the Old Testament. But as we continue to read too, we begin to see that we as humanity and the people in the Bible have rejected God's rest. In fact, we see how humanity changes rest and many other things into what they deem fitting. And when this happens, humanity thinks they're making themselves gods, but really they're leading themselves to their doom. But luckily, Jesus comes on the scene and he shows us that this way of approaching the Sabbath, the way they were approaching the Sabbath, is not correct. And the amazing thing about what Jesus says about the Sabbath is that it comes after Jesus addresses rest. He doesn't address Sabbath until after he says these words to us. Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart. And you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Jesus calls those that believe in him to come to him. Come to him and find rest in him. Why would this come before Jesus addresses the Sabbath? Because when Jesus looked around him, he saw that people were burdened. He saw that people were weary. Jesus eyewitnessed how people have made God's laws into a religion and a ritual rather than a pathway for relationship with the creator of the universe. The Sabbath commandment is not about a law. It is about relational trust with the creator of the universe. And that is what Jesus wanted to show us. That is why Jesus says, man was not made for the Sabbath, but the Sabbath was made for man. We see that Jesus says he is the King and Lord of the Sabbath. So by creating space for a Sabbath, we are actually creating space for Jesus in our lives. Jesus, the Prince of Peace, the Bread of Life, the Holy One of Israel, the Son of God, our Lord and our Savior, that is the person that we are invited to spend 24 hours with. The man that showed us how to truly live. And see, when we enter into the Sabbath, we actually show that Jesus is the King of our lives. And that is why Hebrews states that there remains a Sabbath rest. Because when we enter into the Sabbath, we enter into the rest available from Jesus Christ. We learn to rest, trust, and abide in the presence of God. And when we do that, our soul comes home. Our soul is refreshed. And we are able to dwell in the presence of God. This is what the Sabbath offers us. And we don't just see it here in Hebrews. We see it woven throughout all of the scriptures. In the Psalms, you guys, like, it's all over the place. Like, Lord, help my soul come to your trust. Help my soul be restored. Lord, protect me from my enemies, for my soul is weary. This is what the Sabbath offers us. If you are weary and need rest, learn the art of Sabbath. In the Jewish tradition, the Sabbath would actually start the night before the holy day. And that night, they would read scriptures, they would sit around a table, whoever was there with family and friends, and they would just delight in one another's presence. They would be joyful. They would sit there and just delight in what God had given them. And then on the very next day, the Sabbath day, they spent time with family and friends and resting. The Jewish culture believed that 6 days before the Sabbath are a pilgrim edge to the Sabbath. They believed that the Sabbath gives those 6 days life. But they also believed that those 6 days made the Sabbath be a better rest. Here is what Abraham Heschel, a Jewish theologian, wrote in his book on the Sabbath. He said, "He must say farewell to manual work and learn to understand that the world has already been created and will survive without the help of man. 6 days a week we wrestle with the world, wringing profit from the earth. On the Sabbath, we especially care for the seed of eternity planted in the soul. The world has our hands, but our soul belongs to someone else. 6 days a week we seek to dominate the world. On the seventh, we try to dominate the self." I love this quote so much. Our soul belongs to someone else. Do our lives show that? 6 days a week we seek to dominate the world. On the seventh, we try to dominate self. The Sabbath is a time to stop and enter the peace, rest, and joy and delight that God has to provide. The seventh day is holy, but it should lead us to the other 6 days. We, of course, need to seek to rest and abide in Jesus every single day. In fact, the Sabbath should be more than just one day a week. It should be an art of being. Being with God in every moment of the day, when we are at work, when we're with our families, when we're in creation. The Sabbath is one day that leads us into the 6 other days, ready to trust God more. Because the art of Sabbath leads us to the art of rest, delight, and joy. All these spiritual practices that we have gone over are about creating space for God to do something. By simply observing the Sabbath, we are entering into a process that we allow God to show us what our souls need to rest, what our souls need to come home. By simply being with Jesus, we enter his rest. When we rest on the Sabbath, we are showing that we don't have to push for anything. And it is in this rest that we truly learn to delight. Because when we learn to delight, we learn that everything we need is right in front of us. Everything we need to be joyful, to have delight, is right there. We don't need to seek control. When we get ourselves to the heart of rest and delight, we begin to find joy in the very things and people that are right in front of us and have been there all along. If we're honest, we could all use a day like this. We could all use a Sabbath rest. A day in which we do nothing but rest. A day where we simply delight in the creation and the kids that are around us that so easily annoy us sometimes. But to sit and delight, because guess what? They're only getting older. To find joy in our spouses, to find joy in nature, in the very things that we have. Put the laptop down, put the TV down, put your phone down, and simply enjoy what is right in front of you, your friendships, your relationships, the people that aren't always going to be here. But recognize it's God that gave you those things. We could all use a day like this. So this week, we are inviting you to take one 24-hour day to rest, delight, and seek joy. I understand this is a big ask. I understand that this might be hard. That's kind of the point of spiritual practices. They might be difficult, but they are also the thing that creates space for the creator of the universe to touch our souls. So this is what we are inviting you into. A full day, sun up to sundown, or sundown on the day before to sundown on the day after, if I'm saying it correctly, to do nothing but rest, delight, and pursue joy. A day to lay aside everything and simply be with God. Enjoy your family and friends. Enjoy nature. Enjoy and delight in what God has given you. And like I already said, this is not going to be easy at all. And so I want to give you 5 tips for the Sabbath. The 5 tips, the very first one is stop. Just stop. Stopping is about giving up control and trusting that God will continue to move things forward without you. This might be a harsh reality, but you're not as important as you think. It's okay to stop for a day. Let God continue to show you that He is the king of your life, king or queen of your life, and you're not a king or queen. And that's a blessing. The goal of rest is to be in a place of peace and stillness. And this does not mean you sit and watch TV or sit on your phones. In fact, I would encourage you to turn off your phone and turn off the TV for your Sabbath. Because it's once you do that that you actually learn what makes you really rest. Because watching TV and being on your phone does not actually cause rest. The science proves it. What makes you actually rest? And the truth is, you can't be present on the Sabbath and be on your phone. And real life happens in the place of reality. It happens when we are fully present to the things and places around us. Learn the art of being by seeking the ways to be present with God, our family, our friends, and ourselves. Being present opens our eyes to the things that you have to be thankful for and the things that really we should be worshiping God for every single day. Because the Sabbath can't happen without some form of worship, without some form of being thankful for what you have. And that's why it's a tip on the Sabbath. And I don't just mean like, okay, Nathan, we're just going to listen to worship songs for a 24-hour period of time. That's not what I mean. You can't experience joy and not worship. So if joy is at the heart of Sabbath, we will be thankful. Being thankful is worship. Being joyful is worship. Being willing to thank God for everything He has given you in your life to delight about. So delight in your relationship with God. Delight in your family. Delight in your friends. Because when we observe the Sabbath, we affirm that God is the center and source of our lives. He is the beginning, the middle, and the end. We can trust God to provide and care for us. The Sabbath is unlike any other day. It is a 24-hour period of time where our souls come home. This is what we are inviting you into. A day in which we say the Ten Commandments are not obsolete, but they show us how to center our lives on the ways of Jesus. So let's enter into this rest. Let's sit and set a 24-hour period of time aside to sit and rest and delight in our friends, our families, and the nature and the people around us. And I would encourage you, when you do this, tell someone about your experience. It might be weird at first, I'm going to be honest. It's going to be weird to put your phone aside for 24 hours. It's going to be weird to not turn on the TV for 24 hours. But if you do this, not just this week, but you continue to make this a healthy rhythm in your life, your soul will come home. You will see that the other 6 days of the week are different. You will see that you long and thirst for your Sabbath. And the Creator of the universe is worth spending one day a week with. The Creator of the universe is offering us rest, delight, and joy. May we be willing to strive after that rest. Lord, as we head into a time of worship, God, I pray that we would recognize that it's you who is the reason for our lives. It's you who is the reason that we come here on a Sunday to sing these songs of worship, of delight, and joy to you. You are the reason that we come here and we know that we can lay every burden at the cross because you tell us, come to me, all who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. You don't say you're going to give us a command. You don't say you're going to give us another test to do. No, you say you give us rest. So, Lord, whatever burden that we are carrying, whatever weight we are saying, I can't take a Sabbath, Lord, I pray that we would put it in front of you and say, this is the burden I have. Lord, give me rest. And, Lord, may we be willing to set one day aside to simply sit and dwell in your presence. Because, Lord, we need our souls to come home. I pray these things in your Son's name. Amen.
Amen. I invite you guys to just stand with us as we continue to worship this morning.
There is no one else for me.
So are you wearied and troubled? No light in the darkness you see. There's light for a look at the Savior, in life more abundant and free.
Sing it again, oh soul.
Oh soul, are you wearied in trouble? No light in the darkness you see. There's light for a look at the Savior.
Lord, as we face the day, Lord, just the rest of today, and as we go into a week, Lord, there's something different for each and every one of us that lies ahead. Some of us may feel overwhelmed. Some of us might feel hopeful. And Lord, we can know what we need to do. We can know how good it is for us to turn our eyes to you, Lord. God, we can know the fruit, and we can still struggle. We can still not switch up our mind. Lord, we can go through motions of trying to slow down or trying to be quiet, but we cannot surrender. Lord, we can be doing things out of religiosity just to try to earn favor, and all you're wanting to do is speak to us, to know us. Lord, help us to be satisfied in you, God. Help us, Lord, to turn our eyes to you. Lord, whatever it is that's blocking us, Lord, whatever we're fixing our gaze upon that's not you, Lord, we can know it's good or we can know it's bad. It can be so many different things, Lord. Holy Spirit, would you slowly, gently correct us, remind us, so the things of earth may grow strangely dim in the light of your glory and grace. Go before us, we pray and ask in your name, Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Yes. I was actually going to ask for that. You guys are awesome. Jesus deserves our praise, right? That was amazing. Thank you for sitting down. I'm going to invite you to a couple different things. Tonight, actually, is park night. And so we've had a sign up for it. If you have signed up, you know all of this. It's tonight from 6 to 9 p.m. at the Veterans Memorial Park North. If you've been here the last couple weeks, you know they've been stressing north. So if you don't put that in your GPS, I guess you end up somewhere else. So that's super important. That's tonight. The food is provided for you that have signed up. If you're new here or you forgot to sign up, please still come. Maybe just grab some food on your way and eat with everybody else. That's what I was told this morning. Sounds harsh, right? Okay. And then we have a Nurture Night coming in a couple weeks. It's June 22nd. Nurture is our women's ministry. And many of you have said, hey, what are we doing there during the summer? We're taking kind of a break from our normal Bible study time, but we still want kind of this point of community. So that's what we're going to do. Janice, if any of you know Janice, had felt really bad that the men are being able to play these cool cornhole games. And so she is going to supervise that for us women. So we're going to have fun, we're going to eat together, and then we're also going to have a time of reflection. One of the things that we were challenged with as we ended Nurture this past spring, April, was to do these different reflections called Entering His Rest. And so we're going to pick one of those and do that evening as well to wrap up our time. So that's it for me. And now I'm going to invite up Paul Stanton. Here he is.
Good morning, everybody. All right. So I'm Paul Stanton, and I'm here to talk to you guys about my favorite place in the whole entire world. So it's been 4 years since I've got to stand down here and talk to you about Naples, Italy. So, and so I thought I would do a little bit of a history lesson. So Naples is a place we've run summer camps for 12, well, this will be the 12th time I've done it. So it sounds kind of weird, I know. Always the first objection is people like kind of frowning their brow at you. Italy, what do you guys do in Italy? Yeah, Sean's doing it right there. I can see him. So where this got started is I used to work at a church in the Bay Area. And I still remember 15 years ago, I was sitting in the office and this old missionary came in and started talking about Naples and this kind of weird spot within Western Europe, right? So Naples is a port town in South Italy, and they don't speak Italian. They speak a different dialect that is significantly different. There's a massive earthquake in the 80s, and they built like these very tight buildings, kind of in their projects, basically. And it's a very densely populated town, city in the midst of South Italy. And this missionary had moved there in the 70s and had planted a church and had grown somewhat. And he was telling us that they had back in the early 70s, they had bought this piece of property kind of out on the outskirts of Naples. He had said he had tried to do some things with the land and the buildings there. And he was asking us, like, hey, what would you guys do? And so we said, well, you know, we do a lot of youth stuff at our church, and so we've had a lot of success in our summer camp, so maybe we should do a summer camp there. And he thought it was a great idea. And so I recruited 12 people. We flew over a lot of college kids, and we did an American-style summer camp in Naples, Italy, and it was hot, and it was loud and fun, and we brought a band, and we brought games, and we brought all this stuff, right? And I remember, like, walking around that first year, and there was 33 kids, high schoolers, and I remember walking around thinking, huh, I think this is working. You know, I feel like oftentimes in life, you know, whether work or ministry or whatever, you're always pushing a boulder up a hill, right? And it just feels like, oh man, I'm working so hard, pushing this thing up. Well, when we were there, it felt like I was pushing the boulder down the hill. A little bit of effort and a lot of impact, right? So over the next few years, we started going back. And the next year, there was 70 kids there. The next year, there was 80 kids. Then they started doing 4 camps during the week. So our church would have the high school camp, and then another church would do the middle school camp, another church would do the college, another church would do the family camp. And then there's another church in Portland that started doing them in the north. And it started kind of becoming a thing. And, you know, it's like those Venn diagrams where it's like things that work and things you're good at and things you like, and where they meet in the middle is like the best spot. That's kind of what I felt like this was. And it was like really, really taking on. And the people of the church were doing this great job, right? And it got to a point to where I was looking around thinking like, huh, I can retire, right? So I had gone, and so Creekside had gone. This will be the 7th time Creekside has gone when we moved here. And in 2020, it was going to be my last year of going. I'm like, okay, the people of the church had really, really owned this. They had, you know, started doing it themselves, like I said, the 4 weeks. It was really awesome to see. And then 2020 happened. And so for those of you who remember, like, when COVID first hit, it first hit in Italy, in the West at least, right? And there's a couple of reasons for that, and there's lots. I'll touch on two. One is, if you've ever bought stuff that says product by Italy in it, it means it has to have been made in Italy. So it can't be made in China or you know, Bangladesh or wherever, right? It has to be made in Italy. So in order to kind of get around that, and with the labor laws, what they would do is they would bring, you know, workers to Italy, like immigrants, and then work in their factories there. One of the big places they brought workers from was Wuhan, China. And so it, of course, started a lot of the COVID issues there. And then if you also think about Italy, their culture, right? So they greet everybody with a kiss. They are right up in your face all the time, right? They have no personal boundaries issues, right? So because of that, it also kind of spread very, very quickly there, and it was very intense in those early days. They also have a very aging population. And so those kind of big factors cause Italy to really just lock down tight. And a lot of fear, a lot of scared, and the churches there really, really struggled. And, of course, camps couldn't happen, all this stuff. And so there's been this kind of really hopelessness, especially, you know, the farther you go south in Italy, the more, he talked about religiosity in his prayer. There's like a lot more superstition, a lot more kind of those type of things. And in the south, in Naples, that really, really has taken a really strong hold on the city. And so we tried to, like, think about rebooting in 2021, 2020, 2022, and just there was just, it just couldn't happen, right? Because even last year, I actually spent 2 days there last year, and it was just still really tight. So this is the first year. We're trying it again, and we're really cool. It's really cool to see that we have 66 high school kids that have signed up, and their parents are letting them go, which we were shocked about. We didn't know how the turnout would be. We have 10 folks from Creekside, 10 leaders from Italy, and we're all coming together to try to give them a little bit of a reboot. So couple of things. I could talk all day about Italy and Naples specifically. I am 1 minute overdue, so I have three prayer requests. First, pray for the kids that are there, right, that their hearts will be open. This is the first time I've gone in many, many years where there hasn't been a lot of returning. You think about it, we haven't gone in 4 years. So this is like a new batch of kids. They haven't experienced this. This is going to be kind of weird for them. So please pray for them, for their, like, their fear of being around everybody, number one, but then also just for their hearts. Then two intensely practical things that we need. One is prayer for our own people, a prayer for health and safety while we're over there. But then two, we also need rides to San Francisco Airport on June 28th and then return on July 10th. If you are available to take a group of four or five people, however many, if you have a big van, that'd even be better. We could really use like just some logistical help on that. It's kind of a challenge with this many people going. I would really appreciate that. And I think that's it. All right. Thank you.
Can the elders come on up? We would love to just pray for Paul and the Italy trip and all his prayer requests. So, Joel, since you're the first one up here.
All right, let's pray. Father God, thank you so much for Paul and his heart to serve you and serve the people of Italy. Father, we do just pray for these kids that are coming. Lord, that you prepare their hearts even now to see you, to experience you in real and tangible ways. Jesus, we do ask for safety for the team going from Creekside. Lord, that you protect them, that you lay your hand and blessing over them. And Lord, that they go out and are used by you to be your hands and feet there in Naples. Jesus, we thank you for this group, and Lord, we do just pray this morning, bless them, protect them. Pray these things in your name. Amen. Thank you for coming this morning. Have a great week, guys, and we'll see you next week.
Made some teeth marks, I curse and bless.